I've said that already, but Azure Maps is not just about a map that you visualize stuff on. It's also about the intelligence that you can build with the service itself. Jim, actually one of our cloud advocates, is here on the IT Show today to show us how to implement geofencing algorithms and solutions with Azure Maps. Hi, everyone. You're watching the IT Show. I'm Olivier, your host. Today, we're going to talk about Azure Maps and geofencing, and we have Jim. Jim, welcome to the show today.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
So, Jim, tell us a bit about yourself. Who are you? What are you doing at Microsoft?
So, I'm what's called a cloud advocate. Okay. So, I'm part of the developer relations team, and my job is to just help people be successful with Azure products, whether it's coming on shows like this to present content, whether it's helping with blog posts, videos, documentation, going out doing events, anything I can do just to help people be successful with the amazing products that we build here.
Awesome. So today you came in with a proposal for a night show, which is about using Azure Maps for building application that leverage the principle of geofencing.
Yes.
And lots of people don't know what it is. The other aspect of it, which is interesting, is that Azure Maps is perceived that, oh, you have the mapping. It's like the thing that you're going to have these graphics and so on to visualize buildings, routes, and so on. But actually, Azure Maps is about much more than just that, right? We'll talk a bit about that as well.
Yes, so, I mean, Azure Maps is a whole suite of services. It's not just the control on screen. It's a whole lot of spatial-based services that understand the world, GPS coordinates, and just how to do interactions with those. Okay. Now, geofences are a way of defining on a map a certain area. And you define that using standard latitude, longitude type coordinates.
Okay.
And then what you can do is you can test whether or not a point is inside or outside the geofence.
Okay.
So, for example, if I just flip over to a map here and bring up the little drawy tool, you could imagine you'd want to define a geofence, say, around the Microsoft campus.
Okay.
So I could say I've got a series of lines here that define a border around the campus. And these are defined as polygons. And each of these points that define the polygon are GPS coordinates, so latitudes and longitude, which are sort of measured from around the world. It goes up to 90, down to minus 90, and then this way it's minus 180 to 180.
Yeah.
And so each of those coordinates defines a polygon, and that then defines
your
shape.
Your zone,
Now, the standard way of defining these is with a thing called GeoJSON.
Okay.
So I've got a site here that shows some GeoJSON. And literally, it is just a series of points.
Of points.
So I've got a square here, and I have 5 points. Normally, we don't define squares with five. It's four. But the idea is the last point closes the square. So the last point is the same. So I've got these around an area of Redmond. We're minus 122 longitude, 47 latitude.
Okay.
And then all the area defines the square.
OK, interesting.
So once I've got my geofence, I can then send that to Azure Maps, define it for the Azure Maps service, and then I can send queries to Azure Maps to say, am I inside or am I outside the geofence?
Okay.
So let's just look at some code to do that now. I've got an Azure Maps instance that I've just spun up in Azure.
Okay.
And I'm using VS Code here, and I've built some Python code that uses the REST APIs that come with Azure Maps to, first of all, to upload a geofence and then to query it. So what I've got here is I've got some Python code that I've built inside Visual Studio Code that calls the REST APIs in Azure Maps, first of all, to upload a geofence, and then after that, I query that geofence with points inside and outside to kind of see the results that, that you would get out of these kind of operations.
Okay.
So initially, the code I make, I just load up the GeoJSON. I've got a GeoJSON file here.
Okay.
So the same GeoJSON we saw on that web page earlier. And I take that and I send that JSON up to an upload function. And that then gives me back a location. So that's stored inside Azure Maps. And I get back a URL I can query to download data about that.
Okay. Once you've you've uploaded that GeoJSON, you just do it once, right? It's not every time you have a query, you have to upload that GeoJSON.
Nope. I upload this once, and that is stored.
Okay.
And then once I've got the location of where it is, I can query that location and pull back a unique identifier.
Okay.
And that defines that geolocation.
Okay, cool.
And then once I've got that, I can use my REST API to query that geolocation and find out, am I inside or outside? And it's just one call. I make the call, I pass the latitude and longitude, the unique identifier, the UDID of my geofence, and that brings back some results.
And that's it.
And that's it. Yeah, so if I just, I'll stick some breakpoints on this, and I'll just run this, and we'll kind of see the output that comes out. I click run. This is going to run my Python code. Okay, so my first call uploads my geofence. This is the code that loads that GeoJSON, pushes it up into Azure Maps.
Yep.
And then that should come back with the unique identifier. Cool. Okay, so the function's been run, mm-hmm. and it's returned to me this unique identifier. So I can now use this ID in every single one of the calls
okay,
I make.
Okay.
So the first call I'm going to make is I'm going to check a geofence inside, or sorry, check a geolocation inside the geofence.
Okay.
So I've got a point right in the middle. Mm-hmm. I'm going to make a call. I'm going to call that ID, okay. and I'll give it those coordinates.
Okay.
And it's come back to say, the distance to geofence is -999.
Okay.
I'll come back to that value in a
okay,
minute. It's
okay,
kind of important. But it also defines where on the geofence is the closest location to my point. So it kind
okay.
of shows where I
okay.
am. So if I now run this again with a point that's outside the geofence, uh-huh. you'll see this has now come back with 999.
Not minus, but
okay. positive.
Okay.
And then now I've got another call where I'm right on the edge of the geofence.
Okay.
So I call that, and that comes back with -6. Okay. Now, this okay. seems a bit weird.
Okay.
But it comes down to the fact that GPS is surprisingly inaccurate.
The public one.
The public one.
Yeah.
Obviously, there's even rumors
the
that the military
ones.
One.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So the way GPS works, you have a receiver,
yep.
and that connects to 4 satellites orbiting the
okay.
Earth.
Yep.
And it pulls down time signals, and then it measures the length of time it takes yep. for a signal yep. to get from the satellite to the receiver, and then uses that to trilaterate its position.
Yep. Yep.
Now, the problem is, although the speed of light is fixed, that signal can get slowed down by atmosphere, moisture in the air, it can bounce
yep.
off buildings, so it's not quite accurate. So you're looking to kind of within about 10 meters.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm on the edge of the geofence, am I actually in or out? I could be standing outside,
yep,
but the
yep.
GPS thinks I'm inside. So the way this works is when I make the call, if I zip back up to the code, I specify what's called a search buffer.
Okay.
And anything outside the search buffer is considered to be inside or outside. So this is a search buffer of 50 meters.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm within 50 meters of the geofence, then it returns the distance that it thinks.
Okay.
If I'm more than 50 meters inside or more than 50 meters outside, it yep. returns -999 for inside, 999 for outside.
Oh, okay, got it.
So -999 means I'm definitely inside.
Yeah.
999 means I'm definitely outside.
Okay.
Anything else means I'm within that search buffer.
Oh, okay.
So what I'd then have to do is start building logic into my code to say, is this, am I inside,
yeah,
am I
yeah,
outside?
Yeah.
You may have seen, I don't know if you use a sat nav in your car, sometimes when you're driving along and you go off on a fork
yeah,
and the sat nav shows you're still
like
going that way and then
I
it suddenly
yes.
jumps over.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it is trying to work out where you are. It uses accelerometer data, gyroscope data, it does like a Coleman filter
mm-hmm.
to try and work out where exactly you are and make a best guess.
Okay.
And sometimes it gets it wrong.
Basically, that's a way for you to tune the accuracy of your results, basically, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So you think of kind of example of where you want to use like a geofence.
Mm-hmm.
New Zealand, for example, they have what's called road user charging.
Yeah.
So when you go and fill up with petrol in a commercial car, mm-hmm. you pay tax at the pump.
Yeah.
When you fill up with diesel, you don't pay tax at the pump. Instead, you pay tax later based off the amount of miles you've done on public roads
yeah.
and the weight of your vehicle.
Yeah.
So essentially, you're paying for the damage that you do.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you're driving off-road, why should you pay towards the upkeep of the roads? Because you're driving off-road.
Fair enough.
Fair
yeah.
enough. So take a look.
You're still polluting, though.
Still polluting, yeah. That's obviously a separate tax issue. But in terms of the payment for the roads, the road user charging,
yeah.
if you're driving a logging truck on-road,
mm-hmm.
you pay tax, and then you want to enter, if you enter a geofence, which is your logging area off-road,
okay.
you can then enter the geofence, tag that you've entered the geofence, stop paying tax while you're driving around,
yeah.
and then when you leave, you start paying tax again.
Okay.
Now, sometimes that logging area is right on a road. So once you've kind of, you need to track that you've left the road, you've
yeah,
gone into
yeah.
the logging area, but then when you're driving back near the road,
yeah.
but not actually on it,
mm.
your GPS may pick up that you've left the geofence when
yeah.
you haven't. So that's when you have to start bringing these smarts of where actually am I? Am I at an area where I can rejoin the road? Because
mm-hmm.
if I haven't been through that one exit here,
yeah.
then I might still be.
Still there, yeah.
Yeah, so
okay.
you can't just rely on this being 100% accurate because GPS is just fundamentally not accurate.
Awesome.
Awesome. Now, what's also really cool about this geofence stuff is we can wire up events. So
okay.
inside Azure Maps, we have this whole events subscription
yep.
that puts events on Event Grid.
Yep. Yep.
So what I can do is when I make this call to the geofence,
yep.
I can say alert if there is an event where I enter or leave a geofence.
Okay. Okay.
So I've got a bit of code here that will do that. And then when I actually make this call, I have to define a device ID. So every time I call, I have to say, this is the device I'm checking.
Okay.
And then with that particular device, if I'm outside, then inside,
mm-hmm.
it flags that I've entered the geofence and actually then raise an event on the event grid.
Okay.
So I can actually got some code here that does this. I've got outside, inside.
Okay.
If I run this code, what it will do is it'll be outside, be inside, an event will then get fired inside the Azure Maps through
okay.
the event grid, and that can then be fed to any kind of system.
Yep.
So what I can do here, I've got one here. So 999 outside, event published false. 999
okay.
outside, event published false.
Yep.
-999 inside, event published true. That has published an event onto the event grid.
Okay.
And then what I can do with these events is I can then wire up a logic app. Mm-hmm. If I wanted to build like a no-code type scenario, I can wire up a logic app to this. And then in this particular example here, when the event is fired in the event grid, I can hook up things like a webhook.
Yep.
And from a webhook, I can then connect to something like a logic app.
Yep.
So here I've got a logic app here that when the webhook is called, mm-hmm. it'll post a tweet. So now where I've called yep. outside, outside, inside, in theory, if I go to my Twitter account, you should see under my tweets, my geofence has been entered. Test tweet nice. Using Azure Maps and logic apps.
Nice.
So just by calling the geofence, I've yep. published a tweet. Obviously, that's a bit of an amusing scenario, but still. You think you could put this to, say, notifications. Mm-hmm. A good example of this is if you have expensive machinery mm-hmm. with a location tracker on there, which is in a warehouse somewhere, yep. if that leaves that warehouse, you get notified, because it yep. could have left the warehouse because it's going on site,
totally. Yep.
or it's been stolen.
Yep,
so the fact sense. You can wire this kind of capabilities yep. in, you know, when it enters the area, you know, a truck is yep. entering an area, you get a notification yep. via a push notification to say your delivery's yep. on its way. Yep.
Safety as well. I mean, like you're yes. talking about security and theft and so on. Like safety is one of the major scenarios where you say, hey, I don't want that employee or that machine to enter that zone because mm-hmm. of that risk of like fire or whatever. And then you have it with the geofencing capabilities in the maps.
Yeah, totally. So if you have an area to say, I don't want any employees yep. going to this area during this particular period because something is happening, employees have location trackers yep. on them, mm-hmm. and then if they do enter that area, that breaches the geofence, you get an alert, you can call cool. that employee and say, please leave the area.
Awesome. Nice introduction to geofencing with Azure Maps. Jim, thanks a lot for that one.
Thank you.
If someone wants to learn more, actually, they can go to aka.ms/IoTShow/AzureMapsGeofencing. And this is your link to documentation on more tutorials and more information about using geofencing in Azure Maps. Jim, hope to see you soon on the IoT Show again.
Thank you. See you soon.
Everyone, thanks for watching, and don't forget to subscribe.